privileges. How many of you think I'm privileged? It's more to do with my privilege than to do with my marriage. Because I'm a Hindu, so I can speak about Kashmir without being called a terrorist. If I can't clothe your conscience, there's no point in my resignation about this. I'm also an upper caste. It's the moment I resigned, everybody started asking that useless fellow got into a quota, he should have got into some reservation quota into IAS. And screwing up the stance of one bright general student, I am an IAS. I can come out and speak and people would listen. I am a male. But that's a privilege which I am speaking. And that's a privilege many of you are sitting there are having. Whether you have it or not doesn't matter, but you have to speak up. If you don't speak up for your fellow citizens, then whom do you speak for? If I am not concerned about what is happening in Kashmir, can you ever say he is a fellow citizen? If somebody is pricking you here, okay, on your forefinger somewhere, take blood. Does it hurt here? Does it hurt here? It hurts, right? You don't say that, oh, it's very far away, somewhere here, so it doesn't matter to me. No, this is the nation. It should stain all of us. It should. But it did not. I did not resign in protest against the government. I resigned in protest against this country because we did not, as a nation, we failed. We have our media, we have our judiciary, we have civil society, we have so many of us, you, me, academia, all those things. So many of us. And we all just decided to keep quiet. And we said it is all in national interest. Everything is in national interest. You might be still, right now we are just talking about communication blockade. It took 69 days to start talking about communication blockade. Because in the initial time when I resigned, we were saying that people are celebrating there. That's a video that everybody showed in the media. And that's what we all believed. We wanted to believe. And that's what we went ahead with. That's the narrative we wanted to go ahead with. We are okay. The media is saying we are okay with the restrictions placed by the government on the media. So that's a dangerous thing because before I worked in reserve, and there are 20 years of anti-insurgency operations there. 20 years of anti-insurgency and the rest of the country did not know what happened there because the media did not cover. It is 65-85, so we can say that it was then. But what is now? This is 21st century, 2019, and this is democratic India. And here, our media is saying that we agree with whatever restrictions government has put, we go by what the government is saying. What is supposed to be the media's job? To find out the truth and report. But we are just keeping quiet. In the WhatsApp groups, we are keeping quiet. In the Facebook posts, we are keeping quiet. In the newspapers, we are keeping quiet. Everywhere, we are just, you know, we are so worried, we are so bothered, we are so afraid to speak up our mind. Why? So who is the real anti-national? The person who is speaking up is never the real anti-national. Because he thinks something is bad for the country. The person who is supporting it is also not the anti-national. Because he thinks that is good for the country. The person who thinks it is bad and still decides to keep quiet for his own gains, thinking that, you know, the political scenario would change and then I might be able to join the other bandwagon. You are the real anti-nationals. Because you decide to keep quiet. Wasn't this a historic decision? The 370, removal of 370. I asked, wasn't demonetization a historic decision? We have sort of started making decisions historic before even taking the decision. Today we are going to take Arch Coach Tufani. Let's take demonetization. What was that lab money? Of course, we know 100% money came back. Right? Second was, I'm pretty sure more than 100% came back. The less we document, the more we charge. You know, why a Holocaust would not happen in Germany? Because they documented it very well. Every single person wrote about it 1,000 times. Every single child knows the mistakes they made. We don't do that. We just conveniently made a humongous blunder. We just don't want to look there, you know, put our plastic slipper down there. Nobody knows. The next was counterfeit currency. There is another issue. You know what happened 3 days back, 3-4 days back? RBI decided not to print 2,000 rupees, not anymore. You know what is the reason? High quality counterfeit currency has come. So RBI is saying they are anyway printing high quality stuff. You know, so why duplicate the effort? So now only counterfeit. We are not printing. So counterfeit also gone. Then terrorism. We have second time we are distributing sweets in this country for the end of then Balakot strike also we did end of terrorism, and then we did Kashmir also for saying end of terrorism. 3 months we suffered, this entire country suffered, stood up in queues, people died, people are not even knowing their own money, entire country were made to stand up like that, and that was an experiment. We were all part of guinea pigs, we just did, we were asked to do that, we were told that you can't take your own money. We said yes, it is for national interest. We were told that it is for national interest. So always there would be such kind of things. Once it will be for black money, so nobody can speak up against black money, right? The great decision need not be a good decision. Nobody would understand what it means. But at that point of time, I realized by making those light tweets, you know, light posts, already I am feeling like Bhagat Singh, that I have rebelled against the government. I have rebelled against this, you know, for the country, for the sake of this nation, I have rebelled just by posting one stupid post. If people are made to feel like a Bhagat Singh just by posting on a Facebook or a Twitter, what is happening is self-censorship. Nobody has put you in jail, nobody is asking you not to do it. But you're all deciding to keep, you know, your levels of disagreement to a minimum possible level. And to minimum disagreement, nobody should know. I saw an article, letter to editor on a week, which says, see, why did you decide to cancel Swara Bhaskar's column? She never criticized Prime Minister Modi. She never criticized the government. Then why did you remove her column? Imagine. What is it that you are saying? That if you criticize, then it's okay. She is just giving a different viewpoint without taking names or criticizing government. So that much of space should be there in democracy. Self-censorship. Where we have to shout and scream, we have to shout and scream. When Kashmir happened, we should have shouted and screamed. Instead, we kept quiet. I don't know how is it possible. If you are watching TV, if you are looking at it, how is it possible for you to, you know, understand and listen to what is happening there and just keep quiet like that? How is it possible? When civilian leaders are jailed, imagine tomorrow Maharashtra decides that the petrol price will be increased by 100 rupees. Okay? There will be protest, like this example I take everywhere. What if the Maharashtra government says that I am going to arrest and detain all the opposition leaders? Here. All the leaders. And I am going to put a curfew in the entire state. Because there could be protest, there could be storm building, there could be a road blockade, there could be so many things. Then I am going to shut down the entire communication industry. And there, no landline, no mobile, no internet, nothing. Then you cannot get out curfew. Imagine that. Imagine that for 20 days, 25 days, 30 days. Is it acceptable? No, is it or not?
No.
If it is not acceptable in Maharashtra, why is it acceptable in Kashmir? I am asking a very simple question. Are they part of India or not?
Yes.
Then why do you have different set of standards? But when there's different set of standards is good, rest of the country should keep quiet. Then you say that, no, they were not consulted. Kashmiris were not consulted before taking this decision. So they say, the kid will never agree to an injection. So they say it is for their own good. We are the parents. So that was given. Which parent does not allow the kid right after the injection? That's what we do. We infantilize them without consenting. Then you are not even allowing them the right to react to a government decision. The government has a right to take a decision. I'm not denying that. Government has every right to take a decision. Whether it is wrong, right, constitutional or not, etc., will not be decided by the Supreme Court and other places. But the government has no right to take the people's right to react. Both coexist. The Maharashtra government can say, I am increasing my petrol prices by 100 rupees. That coexists with the people's right to respond to it, saying that we don't accept. And if the government is saying, to protect your own life, to protect your life, you know, the saving your life, I have to take your liberty. That's the argument. Why the communication is not restored, why the mobile phones are not restored, why the internet is not restored, why landlines, you know, all these things. The argument is that it is to protect the lives of the people. Imagine where our government's expectations have come. The government is now saying to its people, we cannot ensure your life and liberty together. Either you pick liberty or you pick life. Forget about development or becoming Singapore. They were saying that we become Singapore in another some time. Forget about all that. Now you have come to a stage where the government is saying you either pick life, because we cannot ensure both. If you give you communication, we cannot ensure your life. And if I give you life, then I have to not ensure the liberty. That's the most incompetent government I have seen, which cannot even ensure the fundamental rights, the basic fundamental rights of right to life and liberty. If I have to put all of you in jail to save your own life, will you be happy? I say that is exactly what is happening. So, this and the way it is done, executive decisions. Constitutional rights are being, you know, taken away by executive decisions. By simple saying orders, this 107, 107, this is for local Monday, 2 day thing. People have been kept under that for months. And this is not just Kashmir, okay? Kashmir is the explicit manifestation of what is happening basically in a lot of places. In the planning, in the government's planning, they were very clear. Whatever you do in Kashmir, the rest of the country is not going to respond. And we were very much, they were very correct. The assessment was absolutely correct. None of us responded. How many of you have detention centers being built? Are we waiting for gas chambers? Because the argument is what? The technology. How is the technology? Is purely for more and more information. The governance, the smart city is becoming more, where the citizen is becoming more transparent to the government. Citizen is becoming more transparent. Citizen is becoming more accountable to the government. Because you are being asked to do a lot of things, right? It's not the government. You are constantly under pressure that am I doing enough for my country? Any of those things, I was writing it initially. It started with give it up. For that, yeah, you started with give it up. We all gave it up. Then they said, give up your cash. We won't take this. We all gave up our cash. They said, or PNC also. They said, okay. So, you know, it just, there are 5-6 like that. You say, give up our peace, you give up our, you give up this thing, you just started. Start voluntarily giving up, and every time they give it up, it becomes historical. And that is something you have to worry about. It's not at all about one government. The thing is that any government which comes, you pretty much go by this narrative. Because the machinery is set. The machinery is set, the bureaucracy works by the president. Whatever happened earlier can happen now. And any decision, be any authority, why is it important to question authority? It is because it is important to know whether the decision is strong enough. Only thing is that if the talk actually helps you to understand what is happening, the larger context is one thing. But something which is very immediate, very explicit, something is happening in our country. This is not happening in some, you know, either Sudan or Yemen or something that we can just continually ignore. This is happening in our country. This is happening in 2019. No, and US Senate is having forward discussion on that, whereas we unfortunately have not been able to. You know, one question that most of the reporters who are going to Kashmir are wasted. How is the rest of the country responding to what is happening to us? How is the rest of the country responding to what is happening to us? Very simple question. What is your answer?
Nothing.
Things do we have to show? Even a small token of a concern will go a long way. It goes a long way. Because I was told this, what is the bureaucrats grow? Political way, execute it in a legally acceptable framework. But when it is in your own hand, you can do it. But when something is happening which is far away, which is happening in like a Kashmir, okay? And I felt my mere presence in the administration was a validation to what is happening. And second, I thought it is important to tell that this is not, I wanted to shout and scream that this is not correct. How do a person do that? So that's why I thought I'd resign. And then I'll just tell that what we are doing is not correct. And as a country, we should at least be concerned about what is happening. Why I said this is explicit and what is implicit is this verb on freedom of expression. This verb of freedom of expression, what happened in Kashmir, because it was very clear. this kind of historic decisions, you know, every 6 months a new shock and awe event happens. Every 6 months. Nala Peace Accord, how many of you remember? That was the first thing that was signed when the government came to power. Nobody even knows what is an accord. It's been 6 years now. But that was a historic thing which happened at that point of time. Then came demonetization. Then came GST. GST, you remember? In the parliament, 12 o'clock in the night, we declared that second independence of India. We declared, I'm not joking. And today we are saying, what happened because of GST? Because nobody, you know, cries about second independence. We should be happy. But we made it look like that, that it is the second independence. We called the parliament session at 12 o'clock in the midnight. So that at the stroke of the midnight, you know, the speech that many wants to give could have been given. People don't care about that. Then came strikes, then came Kashmir, 370, and then now they have already moved on. The next is CAB, Citizenship Amendment Bill, and then our seat is going to come up with this. So people are all going to be, have to queue up again for showing their document and trying to get those that prove that you are Indian. Why should an Indian prove to the government that you are Indian? And then they move to the next one, saying that the next census would be all single unified census. All your documents, your Aadhaar and digital, blah, 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 PAN, driving license, everything would be into a single document. And then they move to fast tag, you might be aware. Because if you want to enter into a national highway, they are saying your vehicle should have a fast tag. So it's like an Aadhaar for a car. So if I am going to an airport, I'm sure some LIU people would be here. Similarly, LIU means local intelligence, so if you have the police. And similarly, if you are on a this thing, if I go to airport, people would know if I am going to when I am going to Delhi. If I go to train also, now if I go in car also, they will know. Because my fast track thing will come. The thing is not about that. What we are seeing as a progress is a pure surveillance thing. What we are seeing as convenience is pure surveillance thing. And without absolutely no privacy law. Europe, there is CCTV, there is cameras, but it is blurred. Okay, you can't see it. You have to take permission from the court or you get an order, and then you get for that duration that encryption removed or the blurring removed, and then you are able to see that. There are standards for it. We are just putting cameras left, right, and center. Even in bureaucracy, you know, it's because it's our family values. We are talking about dissent. Can you dissent in family? How many of us can speak against our parents? The strict family theory and this very strict hierarchical thing goes on. And that happens everywhere. Of course, we cannot get into the family part. But one thing I want to, one question I want to ask, how many of you have left WhatsApp groups? I ask everywhere. So I think all of you are anti-nationals. Why I am saying so? You have to get back. At least as anything, you get back. Because you have left those 200, 300 people to those 3, 4 people who are doing white jamming. This is called white jamming. White jamming is when you flood with democratization information, what you call now. Democratization of information is also flooding with information. So if there is one news and you don't want, let's say in a flyer, if a flyer has Kannan Gopinathan is coming to address, and if let's say somebody does not want that to happen, they don't have to stop you from putting that there. It's a censorship by overflow of information. Censorship by more and more flooding of information. It's a censorship. But it's a censorship by white jamming. Okay? And that's what happens in a lot of WhatsApp groups. And that's systematically happening. And this, and because the people who are, and these contents are ready, those contents are coming. And the people who have to object have to actually personally do the research and search and counter. It's a very painful effort. And then it also takes a toll on the relationship. So what do you think? Whereas they are assuming you are all on their side. They did not think the relationship is at stake when they wrote that. But when you are about the right, you think the right to ruin the relationship. And you think so. If they are not assuming, they are assuming everything is fine with all those kind of messages, why should you think so? So please get back into those WhatsApp groups is one thing. If you can do, get all those WhatsApp groups, tell that I want to be added there and start writing.